Okay, we're going to talk about nutrition misinformation. Why do we care? How do we spot it? And some examples. The number one rule of giving out any kind of health information is that first we must do no harm. So let's reflect a little bit on what kind of harm we can actually do when we give out bad nutrition information. One of the things that we know can happen is people's health can suffer if they're given bad nutrition information. So we can give out nutrition advice that conflicts with their drug nutrient interaction. So they might be on a drug, for example, that requires them to avoid certain foods. And if we don't know that, and we just give out nutrition advice, we could cause harm. We don't know if somebody's taking insulin, if we are talking about low carb diets, and if they go on our low carb diet that we're promoting, and they continue using their insulin, they can actually harm their health. People in the eating disorder world have realized that some harm is being done in high school health classes, in particular to young vulnerable girls who are feeling very insecure about their body and watching these food documentaries in health class. Their health is actually being harmed by this practice because they're developing disordered eating and eating disorders in response to the misinformation being given to them in these food documentaries. We can also harm people's well-being. There's a good body of evidence that shows that fad diets in particular are harmful to people's well-being because it sets them up to fail. And when people fail at a diet, they tend to internalize that and they consider themselves the failure. They get very frustrated, they get kind of hopeless, and their self-esteem and their body image suffers. And this can come from the original information that we gave them. We can also harm people's trust in the science. When we give out bad nutrition advice and it either backfires or they find out from someone else that it wasn't actually true, what we gave as advice, the public begins to wonder who they can trust. And so this erodes their trust in everybody and even the scientists. We can also harm their pocketbook. And so if we give out nutrition advice that somehow implies that they have to purchase expensive supplements or more expensive food products than they don't actually need to buy, this can be hurtful in their pocketbook. There was an interesting study that showed that low-income people who had a very limited food budget, but were believing that they needed to purchase organic fruits and vegetables in order to be healthy, they were choosing instead to not purchase any fruits and vegetables because they mistakenly believed that if they couldn't afford organic, then it wasn't worth buying the non-organic fruit or vegetable, which is not true. So just to ground us in the foundation of our field, we are an evidence-based field. What does evidence-based mean? Where do we get our evidence from? Our evidence comes from published research, and it's not just published research. It has to be published research that has gone through peer review. So our evidence has been published in peer-reviewed journals. Remember that there are different levels of evidence, and so a letter to the editor might be published in a peer-reviewed journal, but that's not evidence. It's just food for thought. Whereas a clinical trial is strong evidence if it's published in a peer-reviewed journal. If a lot of studies are done and find the same results, that means that that evidence has been replicated. And now we have very, very strong evidence. This is typically what we find in a systematic review or a meta-analysis. But if we want to know if something is accurate, it will be found in that published research. That's where we find our evidence. Okay, there's three categories of misinformation, and we'll talk about those. Number one is food fads. This is probably the most common type of misinformation out there. A food fad can also be called a fad diet. But this comes and goes, and it will always be around. There will always be fad diets in the news that people are talking about and that your Aunt Margaret is talking about. There always has been and there always will be, but we need to recognize them as a type of misinformation. And so a fad diet is one that makes unreasonable claims or exaggerated claims. They focus on particular foods that you should eat or shouldn't eat, and they offer these special health benefits that you'll get just by eating this particular way. The cartoon I have on the bottom is a poking fun at the gluten-free fad, where a lot of people lost weight because they ate gluten-free, but it wasn't really the gluten-free that helped them lose weight. It was just, they just started eating kind of less food in general and eating healthier overall, just kind of in that process. So how do you recognize a food fad? And yes, I have the paleo diet here that I'm poking fun at. I know that some of you might be very fond of the paleo diet, and that's okay. I'm not saying that it's something that you should avoid, but we all need to realize that it does fall into this category of a food fad. So food fads or fad diets, a lot of times will restrict certain foods. A lot of times they'll restrict entire food groups. So for example, the paleo diet, one of the claims that is made is that we are not equipped to really digest grains very well because our ancestors did not eat grains, and we haven't evolved enough to really be able to digest grains very well. And so the paleo diet restricts grains. Well, there's a whole body of research that demonstrates that whole grains in particular have wonderful health benefits. And also the evidence shows that we are perfectly equipped to eat grains, whole grains. And so there's really no reason to get rid of grains other than the rules of this diet. So that's the second indicator that this is a food fad. There will be certain rules that need to be followed. Most of these fad diets will overpromise, and so they will, you know, make promises that really don't come true exactly. And a lot of times they will ignore contrary evidence. So back to the paleo diet with whole grains. The paleo diet won't mention the research on the benefits of whole grains. They'll just ignore that altogether, or beans, for example. And then a lot of times, in order to prove or convince people that this diet is worth doing, there's a heavy use of testimonials or anecdotal stories rather than actual evidence. Now here's the tricky part. Fad diets can and often do have some evidence and research behind them. So when a diet becomes popular, let's say the keto diet or intermittent fasting, very often scientists will go ahead and they'll study these diets and see if they actually work in certain situations. And so you can usually find research studies that used these diets and maybe even found certain benefits. This is sometimes called cherry picking when someone promotes a fad diet based on these small studies or these limited studies. Usually the benefits, if the studies show a benefit, usually the benefits focus on short-term benefits. It's usually weight loss, and it's short-term weight loss. And usually there are specific benefits, and so it's not that they make you healthier overall, it's that maybe they helped people to lower their insulin resistance by 5%. So it's not really broad benefits usually that's studied. And usually these scientific studies don't focus on long-term because it's just very difficult to do long-term studies, especially on a new diet. They also don't tend to focus on mental health. This is one of the things that drives me crazy about the intermittent fasting craze, is that a lot of people's mental health can suffer when they're put on such a restrictive kind of regimen. And even though the research might show that they might lose weight, well, what about their mental health? If they're struggling and they're suffering, is it really the best way for them to lose weight? And then that leads into the sustainability. So these studies don't really look at how sustainable these changes are. Is this something that a person can live with for life? Now, that's not to say that these fad diets should be totally rejected. It's not true. Some people have achieved short-term weight loss on various bad diets, and that weight loss, we know, can be a very healthy thing for them to do. And if it does not interfere with their mental health, and so they go on, say, a keto diet, and they lose 10% of their body weight, and now their insulin resistance is improved, their blood pressure is improved, they feel great, and they intend to now learn how to eat a more moderate, healthy diet, then that's great. There's no problem there. If they did not suffer with their mental health, if they understand that this has just got them to where they needed to be, and now they're going to implement some more sustainable, healthy changes, then that's just fine. A lot of times fad diets are necessary for people that need some sort of structure. And so that's the allure of these types of diets to most people, is that gives them something to hold on to. It's a structure where they don't have to think about it, they just follow it. And this is very appealing to a lot of people. And then it's important to remember that some diets that some people might call a fad diet actually have an enormous amount of evidence behind them. So the DASH diet, for example, does have certain rules, and it is a prescribed diet, but it's actually well researched and provides really good results. And so it's a well-respected diet. It doesn't fall in the same camp as, say, the cabbage soup diet that's very, very restrictive. The second type of misinformation that's out there is darker, and this is health fraud. This is the promotion of misinformation that's deliberate and done for gain. And so it can be easy to spot sometimes, but sometimes not. I have an example here of one of the common things that people get suckered into, and that is that there's ads where you can send in your hair and they'll analyze it and tell you what your diet is missing. And guess who sells the supplement that you need? It's the company that analyzed your hair. So this is fraud. It's health fraud. It doesn't actually exist in evidence. They're trying to sell their product. Fraud can be easy to spot, but sometimes it can't. So this is an example of a website that's saying that there was a weight loss pill that got the biggest deal in Shark Tank history. Now, we all know Shark Tank, and this is like exciting news, right? Like, obviously, if it got approved by the Shark Tank judges, they must believe in it. And so the public could get suckered into this. And then they've got all of these things on here, logos as seen in Style Watch, Today Show, Red Book, and then it goes on and on and on this website. And of course, you can buy the supplement on this particular website. But is it accurate? Is this true? Well, no. It's not true. In fact, that particular website has gotten into a lot of trouble, but it keeps popping up, and it sells various things in the same method, but it's not true. It's a complete scam. It's health fraud. And so Shark Tank did not endorse a keto diet pill. This is from Snopes.com, which is a fantastic website to check these things out. Very often it'll go through the evidence and tell you whether or not it's true or not. But this one has been rated as a scam. The third type of misinformation is more subtle. This is called a misdirected claim. These are claims that lead consumers to make incorrect inferences or generalizations about a food, whether they assume that a food is going to do more than it really will. And so there is criticism. For example, you may have heard the term superfood being tossed around and labeled on foods. Some health experts say that this is actually a misdirected claim, that there's no food that qualifies as a superfood, and that's because it's just promising too much. Certainly there are foods that are healthier than others, but that label itself might actually be considered a misdirected claim if people are interpreting it to be more than it actually means. A lot of times misdirected claims are used to try to lead people away from certain foods. Sugar is probably the most notorious of this. When you read about sugar, very often people will say that sugar is a toxin, that it's a poison, but that's not actually true. So sugar is certainly empty calories, and most of us do get too much, and we would benefit from getting less, but it's not a poison. Our body handles sugar just fine. It certainly is not healthy in high amounts, but it's not the same thing as a poison. So this misdirected claim can be more tricky to avoid, but it's definitely something that we need to keep our eye on.